Now, I'm delighted to say I'm joined on the line by Darren O'Dea. Darren, how are you?
I'm very well, thanks.
So we have the Old Firm coming up this Sunday. Games don't get much bigger than this, but you're a man who is no stranger to this fixture. You've played in quite a few of them and scored in a couple of them as well. So what's the week in the build-up to an Old Firm like for a player?
In terms of the preparation and the training, it's quite similar. But there's no doubt the kind of city goes into euphoria. The newspapers, the radios, the TVs are full with the coverage and the kind of lead up to the game. There's a huge, huge build up, and it kind of builds to a fever pitch that by the time kickoff comes, both sets of fans and players are wound up to the max. So you find it's usually a frantic type of game, and I expect no different, especially with the way the two teams are going at the minute and the scrutiny on both teams that the game on Sunday will be the same.
Is that something that comes into the heads of the players as well, that this really is the game that people are watching, all the eyes are on this, even the neutral eyes are on this game, that if you make a mistake in this is where it actually tells?
Yeah, I'd be lying if I said it's any different. This in every game at Celtic is a huge game, and they've every game you're expected to win and win in style, and it's a hugely demanding environment. But I was brought up as a kid in the academy, and you were told that you'd play 30 games in the season, but you'd be judged off the Rangers games and when you go into the first team, the European games as well. So these are the big ones. The spotlight is massively on you, and these are games that make heroes or break you. So you see the ones that have the courage to still play in the right way and be able to take the ball and play in a really, really hostile environment. So absolutely, the players will be very, very aware of the pressure and listen, the fan bases, the pressure that comes with that as well is enormous. So you need to be a big personality to impose yourself in these games.
Yeah, and Rangers obviously won the last Old Firm at Celtic, and that was the first time they've beaten Celtic in Celtic Park, and I think it was around about 10 years, but when you were playing for Celtic, it was probably the peak of this rivalry, because if you look at the record while you were there, it's 11 wins for Celtic, 12 wins for Rangers, and then 5 draws. So it was very much tied up at the top.
Yes, certainly in my time, there was no kind of favourite. It was each team would go in, and it was whoever performed and on the day, and sometimes it was whoever handled the pressure and the atmosphere better that kind of ended up going away with wins. I was involved in some massive wins, some of the best nights in my career, and also there were obviously some of the toughest moments in your career, losing the games. The kind of aftermath of the game is huge as well. The euphoria of winning one is brilliant, but losing one and you kind of find yourself, you're desperate for the next game to come to kind of get over it. You wouldn't be going out into the city in terms of having dinner or even shopping. You'd stay very low after the game. So the aftermath is huge as well. And the ones that have experienced that will know that. So now certainly it's evened up a little bit. Obviously Celtic are still very much the strongest team in Scotland, but Rangers have done much better this year, so the game has become less of a formality than it was in previous years, so it has the makings of another really good game.
Yeah, and the opening 10 minutes of the games always tend to be very frantic, and that's probably the nature of how big of a game it is. When you're on the pitch in an Old Firm, does the game sort of take a life of its own, and how difficult is it to even just get a grasp of it as you look to get the win?
It's funny, it was one thing that you're always taught as a kid, and again, I talk about the stuff I did as a player in the academy, because it was always into a lead-up into these fixtures, was talk to your teammates and help each other out. In these games, you're on your own. You need to know where your teammates are. You can't hear each other from 15 yards apart, so you need to be very, very aware of what you should be doing on the pitch. And that's the words I would use. You're on your own when you go out there, because it's very hard to communicate. You say the first 10 minutes are frantic. These games, in my experience, they're frantic for 90 minutes. They never die down. It's important you as a player stay calm and composed in the environment, but the actual game never really loses intensity. So they're fantastic games to play in. They're unique. The atmosphere is incredible. And certainly on the pitch, there's no other game I've played in my career that's comes close to it in terms of intensity. So you're absolutely right. The first 10 minutes will be frantic, but again, as I say, in my experience, it doesn't die off.
And I mentioned in the intro that you've actually scored in an Old Firm game. It was in the 2009 Scottish Cup final where Celtic won 2-0. What's it like in that moment to score? I know it's a little bit different because it's in Hampden Park and it's not in front of your home crowd. It's 50-50 split. But what's that like as a player to know that you've scored in the biggest game of the year?
It was the League Cup final in 2009. It was actually an extra time. It's something now I look back on, and it's obviously one of the best moments of my career, and it was fantastic. Obviously, the euphoria scoring any goal is brilliant. Don't get me wrong, it was special at the time, but in all honesty, the whole mindset at Celtic is you just want to win the game then. So the minute the kind of kickoff goes again, all I cared about was actually winning the game, because that's how you're remembered here. Is if you win leagues and cups, you're successful. If you come second in leagues and cups, you're a failure. So certainly the euphoria scoring the goal was fantastic, but it quickly leaves, and all that I was thinking about was winning the game. And obviously once we won the game, we celebrated rightly. But again, at Celtic, you probably had 24 hours grace, and it was a back onto the league campaign, and you have to go and try win that. So it's relentless, and that's why I'm talking about it takes huge character and personality at this club. And we're lucky now at the minute we're led by Scott Brown, who's the biggest personality of all, and certainly he's got plenty of other allies in the team.
Yeah, in terms of modern day Celtic and Rangers in the league, it's really showing probably last year and this year again after Christmas that Celtic are really used to winning week in, week out in this league, and they're used to getting over that line, and maybe that's a reason why Rangers have fallen off a cliff after Christmas.
Yeah, you could argue that is. I think the know-how of having to win games and being calm in games, even if you go behind, to stay calm and stick to what you're good at and your game plan, I think the experience does help. Listen, in my personal opinion, Celtic are better players, so that obviously helps as well. So combined, Celtic at the minute are in a very strong position. Again, going for an unprecedented quadruple treble. There's an awful amount of work to do to get there, but they're in a very strong position in the league and then obviously in the semi-final of the Cup. So, and obviously I've already won the League Cup. So this team is a team you don't doubt, them, along with the manager who's been there as a player and of course as a manager. They're in a very strong position, but no one's at the club would be under any illusions how difficult winning a game on Sunday will be. But if they do, it'll be a fantastic occasion, because it'll certainly put them into a really, really strong position leading into the end of the season.
Yeah, and you're actually working within the club now. Is there a sense, is there a feeling within the Celtic camp at the minute that they're on the cusp of history, or is it very much just get to the next trophy as quick as they can? Like, do they feel the fact that they're going for their ninth title in a row, that they're really on the edge of something special here?
No, I think fans and probably support staff around the club, of course, who are fans, would maybe speak of these things. In all honesty, the players don't have a choice. They're not even thinking of trophy to trophy. They're just thinking game to game. The demands of playing at the club is just enormous. You're kind of one game away from, I don't want to say a crisis, but the kind of scrutiny you're constantly under is enormous, and people that don't know the Scottish game and don't know Celtic don't understand the pressures that come with it. So no, the players, it's not something the players would ever discuss at all. They're probably concentrating on Sunday, and win Sunday, obviously it puts them into a better position, but again, they won't start thinking of anything further than the next game. And these boys are remarkable that they go and play. Some of them are playing upwards of 60 games in a season, year on year, and they're demanded to win every one of them. It takes special personalities, and as I said, we're lucky at the club at the minute. We've got some fantastic personalities and players. So long may it continue.
How have you found your move into management then, and how are you getting on with the under-18s?
Oh, it's been brilliant. I've absolutely loved every minute of it. It's obviously completely different and new for me. I've started to realise how difficult players can be, as much as I love them. So I'm nearly finding my address book to ring all the coaches that I had to apologise how awkward I was as a player. I realised probably how tough I was to manage at times. But no, the kids here, we've got a fantastic young bunch of players, and my job is to obviously breed winners, but the main thing is to breed first team players. So we've got an excellent group, and hopefully that'll continue, and it's up to us to give them everything they possibly can to take the necessary steps to the first team.
And there's a couple of Irish voices within Celtic as well. Damien Duff is obviously working with the first team along with Neil Lennon. A couple of Irish players went into the Celtic team, Luke O'Connell. I know Afolabi has gone out on loan, and Leo O'Connor as well. How are the lads finding it over there?
Yeah, they've done great. Obviously, two of the boys are out on loan and in the Championship and doing well, by all accounts. And Luca had an injury a while ago and has come back and is in good form at the minute. So hopefully it can have a good end to the season. And yeah, as you say, it's lucky actually all three of the first team staff in the manager and John Kennedy as assistant, and obviously Damien Duff as coach. I've been lucky and fortunate enough to play with all of them, so I share really good relationships with them. Damien's a fantastic coach. I'm sure he'll even go on to big things in probably management on his own right, but certainly at the minute he's at the start of his coaching career. Phenomenal, but he's a phenomenal coach. He's not just a top ex player that's gone into coaching. He's fantastic, and he's great for me and a support for me as well. So I'm very fortunate here that I've got fantastic coaches all around.
In terms of developing players for the first team, is there sort of a one system fits all for the youth teams as well, that you're training them to play the same style of football as the first team, or are they developing them firstly to get the skills, get the basics, and then have the mentality to break into the first team?
No, it's something we probably talk about a lot. My idea of success in the academy is producing first team players. The ultimate success is producing Celtic first team players. Now, we're very aware that that's a huge demand and very, very tough to do, but no, we try to produce the kind of the guidelines we would work to is we've tried to work to create Champions League players. So that's in every department of the football side, and whether it be nutrition, sports science, whatever side, we try to work to a Champions League level for the players. Now, ideally, we'd say that every one of them would become Celtic first team players. That would be our goal. But we obviously have a responsibility to know that that's not going to be possible all the time. But ideally, then you're looking around in 5 years' time, and you see players that've been in this academy, and they're scattered around the Scottish Premier League and the Championship. And I can talk from my own experiences. I've been in the youth team here that probably 75-80% played in the Scottish Premier League. That's success. We obviously are here to create Celtic first team players, but obviously there's a responsibility to create football players as well. So we try to get the balance right with that.
Darren, thanks very much for taking the call, and hopefully all goes well for the rest of the season.
Brilliant. Thank you.
Cheers. Thanks, Darren.